Saint Germain shares that there are many portals through which we can experience this gift of silence and the magic of stillness. And the first that he'd like to highlight is meditation on light. When we focus on and go into the light that we meditate upon, the light through its own innate intelligence will surround us and suffuse us with the light of our I Am presence, which is perfect peace, is perfect stillness. So light itself is the alchemical key, as we have heard from the master and his earlier books on alchemy. Light is the alchemical key. So since light is the alchemical key, it is the key to anything that we desire. If we desire greater oneness through the stillness, the light itself will serve us. The light will do its perfect work in bringing us to this fount of inner peace, inner calm, inner poise, inner joy that we just sang about, inner fire. So that's the first portal, light itself. And of course, God created the universe with light. So since God used light to create everything that is, it must be magical, it must be wonderful. It really is what we can go to as the first thing that we desire to fully bathe ourselves in and utilize in this alchemy of ascertaining and then mastering this art of stillness. The second is mindful listening and awakened hearing. When we are mindful, we are in a quiescent state of deep awareness through observation, where we still that mind, the monkey mind, and by stilling the monkey mind, we allow the higher mind, the Christ mind, the Buddha mind, to take hold. And through that awakened state of Buddhic beingness, we hear more than we could hear and understand, because we are in a deep state of listening, grace. So mindful listening, observation, being somewhat detached from the goings on and the noise around us and within us, is a key to this wakeful state of silence and stillness. The third portal is divine love. When we are in love, in true love with God, that love quiets everything. It brings us to this perfect point of cosmic effulgence. It nourishes all of our cells so that they can be kind of still in their own right. Because love is healing, love is soothing, love is calming, love is comforting. And in this world today, we are troubled. We live in a troubled world. And love detroubles us, it untroubles us, it allows us to not worry about anything, because we're in that sacred space of bliss, of that love, and we forget about all of our troubles, all of our problems, all of our issues. We may have physical ailments, yet when we're in love with God, in love with another, we're in the bubble, in the perfect zone of beingness, where magically we're just raised out of those issues, those troubles. And so we're in the bubble rather than the trouble. And we are in that bubble through love. Love is magical. Love is beautiful. Love is the creative power of the universe. And so when we enter that, we can be stilled and away from and safe from all that assails us, that is troubling, that is worrisome, that is antithetical to who we are. The fourth portal is perfect surrender and letting go. And in this state of letting go that is akin to what happens every night when we go to sleep, we surrender our body and our, hopefully our minds that are working a lot during the day and our bodies which have worked and everything that's been active into an inactive state. But it's not a bad state of inactivity. It's not an idleness that's negative. It's a very heightened state of allowance of our subconscious to now take hold of us, even our higher self, to be present front and center, our superconscious self. We rise out of our physical body at the soul level, and we've let go of the world and all of its inanity and sanity, and we relax into that state, that quiescent state of stillness and peace. So our bodies are very still. Hopefully we've let go of the mindsets that where our minds are racing and thinking about the next day or thinking about jobs or work or problems or other people. We just have to relax out of that state where everything is in motion. So we enter a non-motive or non-modal state. Our bodies are still. And so, and Paramahansa Yogananda's teaching and the energization exercises, we energize our bodies and then we relax, right? The relaxation is very important. He speaks about this in the lessons, the SRF lessons. And so by letting go and surrendering and relaxing, we can enter stillness, enter that state of magic silence. It's a beautiful state when we can go to sleep, and we all love getting in our beds, being in the comfort of that space where the worries of the day just disappear. We've done our work, we've done our service, we've served others. Hopefully we've given a lot, we've striven a lot, we've done a lot, and now we just kind of let go of all of it. So you can translate this relaxed state akin to when we go to sleep to actually throughout your day once in a while just stop what you're doing, breathe deeply, and enter this heightened state of awareness and stillness that's very beautiful. The next portal is the holy breath and pranic breathing, deep, slow pranic breathing. This naturally brings us to stillness. It's a key in meditation, as all of us know. It's a key in yoga. It's a key for sports, for any activity. Before you speak in front of an audience, you know, if your solar plexus is racing and you're a little bit antsy or not relaxed, slow down the breathing. It brings you to peace. It brings you to that point of stillness where your God self takes command. Your higher mind becomes active. The subtleties of your divine presence can get through the empowerment that comes through the oxygenation of your blood. All of your cells are nourished and nurtured. As you breathe deeply, the toxins leave through the out-breath and through the skin, etc. And through that holy breath, you access more Holy Spirit prana, chi, and you actually enter a sacred state when you commune with the Holy Spirit, where you can feel your divinity. You can feel your oneness with God. So this portal is very important. The sixth portal is through detachment from the world, the synthetic society, by going into nature and being very present in nature, observing as we did in the second one with through mindful listening and awakened hearing, but observing what's around you with elemental life, with the greenery and the verdure of the flora and the fauna. It is such a wonderful feeling to be in nature because God created this beautiful nature around us as our natural habitat, as the environment that God desired for us to live within so that we could be whole, we could be pure, we could be just one with God, with nature and with God and ourselves. So in nature, which brings us to stillness, we can have many divine experiences. We receive intuitional teaching from the elementals and the plants and the trees and all of our friends in nature. Nature is so soothing and healing. The greens, the autumn colors, the spring colors, the summer colors are just there to, through our eyes, bring us to this whole state of being. And in that wholeness, we are also in the stillness and the security of God and the wonderment of the creation and the magic of the moment. Now, there are other means or portals through which we can come to silence and stillness, and you may have discerned them and used them on your spiritual journey. These are the ones that Saint Germain is highlighting today because they are seminal, they are important. Each one can support the others, so some of them we can do simultaneously. If we're meditating on light, we can also do deep breathing. We can let go. We can be in nature when we're meditating, and we can also be in mindful listening. It's really wonderful to combine some of these portals or elements of how we enter stillness and the great silence, because they become more powerful when we do two or more at the same time. This relaxed state of being is so important in today's world because we all know the stress, the strain, and the issues that occur even within our body temple because of that stress and that strain of having to, quote, make a living, run around, do things that seem to be important. And sometimes they are important, you know, serving our family and preparing meals and teaching and doing our work to have the money and the resources we require. Yet even while doing things, we can be in a quiescent, mindful state of being where a part of us is connected to our I Am Presence, as Saint Germain teaches us, and that we are in love with God, we are in communion with what is real within us and within all life. And so the key is rest in motion, but what are we resting in? Our I Am Presence, our God Presence. So we're resting in our presence, yet we can be active or non-active in our restful state of being of our presence. And of course, when love is front and center through everything that we do, when we are loving, we are kind, we are compassionate, we are understanding and merciful, that love will calm those around us as well as ourselves, so that the calming effects of that love bring others in our environment to stillness. And this itself is a very powerful means to help the planet, to help all people. It's amazing when you walk in nature, let's say you go on a hike and you encounter others, maybe with their dogs. When you are in the zone of your I Am presence in a very peaceful and powerfully loving state of being, those animals will respond. And this has happened to me, I'm sure it's happened to many of you, where these animals that are very sensitive will sense your light, your love, your holiness, your peace, your inner peace. And they will, you know, desire to be in your energy field to absorb that too. And the angels love it when we are in the state of stillness and this grace of silence, because they can get through to us, right? Our higher muses, the ascended masters, can actually communicate easier when we are still, because that's when we can listen, that's when we can hear. So if you would like to commune more with the ascended masters, if you would like them to communicate directly with you more and more, being in the state of listening grace is really important, because they do try to get through to many of us, you know, and sometimes it's when we're not in our left brain that they can get through, when we're just kind of in a detached state and we're not really thinking about anything. Maybe we're washing dishes or we're between doing things, and there's this pause, this sacred pause. And then, voila, something dawns within our consciousness, something arises within our higher mind, our higher mental body, and then we receive the answer to a problem, a dilemma, an issue. You know, something is inspired upon us. Oh, I have to communicate with that person, and maybe that person needs us right in that moment. A phone call, an email, a text, whatever, or a personal, you know, person-to-person interaction. How many people have had this experience of being in that quiescent state, maybe the what I call the pause? You got a download, and then you acted upon that right away, and you found out that the other person was in need, and you were there at exactly the right time to help or to be, you know, a boon for them. How many people have had that experience? I think all of us have, right? So our I Am presence is in a constant state of communion with us, communing with us. Sometimes it's an active communication. Sometimes it's simply a being there to focalize light to surround us and protection and divine energy and frequencies that support our work, our service, our mission, our vision. Yet the I Am presence is always here, right? It's always there. Yet are we allowing it? Are we accepting it to be at the center of our focus, our life, our being? That's the key. If we are allowing God to live, move, and have his, her being within us, then we will have our victories day after day, hour after hour. If we get distracted to the point where we lash out or react or do things that we regret later, well, in that moment, we weren't fully in league with or in alignment with our I Am presence. And so we did things that later we regret, right? So calming ourselves and living in this partially quiescent state, even while we're active, is very important. And we will live longer, we will be happier, others will be happier around us, especially. I think that's the key. It's like, you know, we may be happy in our own mind, but are we also there helping others to be happy? You know, it's like we may be locked and loaded in God, you know, determined to get things done, and yet be so over-focused that we're in kind of overdrive to the point where, you know, we've ratcheted things up and we're in the white fire of the ascension energy, but, you know, we don't have time for others, or somebody has a need and we're not listening or we're not offering help. So I think that there is a balance here, right? We do desire to be focused in our work, yet always attentive and listening grace to meet whatever needs and requirements that the universe has. And sometimes that is really important too. So does anybody have any questions for the master regarding anything that he's shared now through this understanding of these six different portals to stillness and silence? Any questions? Or maybe, you know, if you have a personal experience, fine, but it's more of a time for questions for the master. And those on the broadcast can text too. Silence is a gift, the master says, because our presence is our greatest gift. And the silent watcher within our presence, the silent watcher, the silent observer, the silent emanator, is always there to offer these sacred gifts of spirit, the virtues of God, the virtues of the Holy Spirit, the gifts of the Holy Spirit are always available. Yet they only come to those who are first willing and intrepid enough to ask for them, and then observant and sensitive enough to receive them. And then finally, who have enough virya and will to use them. So this gift of silence is stupendous. And when we enter the great silence, it is an access point to the singularity of perfection, the master says. Stillness, silence is an access point to the singularity of our perfectionment in God. So if you desire to be more perfect, not humanly, in a divine way, through love, use these methodologies or these portals to perfect your heart, perfect your mind, perfect your will. And by balancing these three, perfect love, perfect will, perfect mindfulness and wisdom, we come to that balanced Christ consciousness where a threefold flame is blazing, it's spinning, it's growing, it's expanding to nurture more life around us. We will have more abundance, Saint Germain says, when our threefold flame is expanded, because naturally that flame draws to it more light and energy. So if you don't have enough abundance, focus on your threefold flame, expand that threefold flame, magnify it, and it will draw to you all that you require. You don't have to do hours and hours of abundance calls. If you are in the zone of a balanced and expanded threefold flame, the power of that magnetism, that divine magnetic energy of God within you blazing forth, will naturally deliver to you all the essentials of life. So if you find that you're always struggling, you know, paying your bills or whatever, maybe it's because there's something a little out of kilter with your threefold flame, and you can discern through the Holy Spirit what it is that you are required to work on a little bit more in balancing it and then expanding it. Yet when you do this, when you focus on expanding that, it becomes a magnet to draw to you everything. Virtues of God, abundance, you know, your partner, your perfect partner, your perfect job, you know, everything, your state in life, your place, you know, your home that you desire. Everything will magically come to you when you allow it through the stillness and the power of the presence manifesting through your threefold flame. I think we forget this key teaching, and we think that we have to do all these other alchemical, you know, things to manifest our abundance, when really it's pretty simple. Expand the magnet of your heart, right? Yeah, Boyd, go ahead.
Kathleen asks, "Beloved Saint Germain, would you please speak a bit more on portal number one, light?"
Well, light has everything that you require. You know, when we get to the point of being an ascended master, we live on light and fire, right? We know that. This is what we absorb. This is what we feed off of. And as we get closer and closer to this divine diet of light and spiritual fire, we refine our, you know, what we take in with food. Why? Because we're going directly to the light. You know, we solar gaze, we meditate on the sun at dawn and through the sunrise. We absorb more solar intelligence as we meditate. You know, I was talking to Aaron Rose the other day. His daily ritual is, no matter where he is or what he's doing, he's there for the dawn and the sunrise. He goes outside. He goes to a place where he can meditate. We were doing this before. We have gotten away from it a little bit with our morning broadcast, but I love being outside at, you know, 6:30 in the morning or earlier, depending on what time the sunrise is, because I always receive mystical teaching. So if you're a late nighter, you know, that's great for getting certain work done when it's still at night, you know, when everybody's asleep. Yet the magic of the dawn and of the sunrise is so powerful that the great masters, El Morya, the first ray of the dawn, you know, what is the first ray? It's not just blue, it's the first ray of the dawn. And Omran Mikhail Ivanov and Babaji, all these great masters have mastered the science of arising early and making contact with that first ray, that first inkling from the sun, because they know that within that intelligence is power too. The power to transform their day, the power to transform their consciousness, the power that the sun wields and then gives us, offers us, to allow us to evolve and to grow and to expand. So, you know, with the light, you can do anything. Without light, you can't do anything, really. I mean, we can't really work in darkness. We can only really, truly work in the light. So use the light in your work, Saint Germain says, but be the light. The light will serve you. It is the greatest portal. That's why he listed it first, for co-creation, for procreation, for everything. So I actually had it as number 4 or 5, and then he said, no, that's the first one. So light is the alchemical key. You know, write that down, put it on your refrigerator, and then as you eat your meals, as the Master Omram shares, chew consciously, absorb the light within the food. It will serve you better. You can eat less and get more done, you know, when you're lighter. It's a lesson for me. It's amazing how after these services, I feel so supercharged with light, I'm not really hungry anymore. Have you felt that? I mean, it's like the food that we have is not just bread. Man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word which proceedeth out of the mouth of God. Well, that word that proceeds out of the mouth of God comes with light. Okay, another question?
Yes. Carol Lazar asks, can you explain about the breathing that you suggested? Is it pranayama or something else?
Well, it is pranayama, and it is absorbing the prana and the chi within the environment. Yet he called it the holy breath, so that is akin to the Holy Spirit, because spirit and breath are synonymous, really. So it's entering through the Holy Spirit into the graceful state of deep, slow, abiding breathing, where through that breath you can enter stillness. See, all of these are how to enter the silence and stillness, right? So can you enter there when your breath is like this? You know, you've been running for a mile and it's hard to be still at that point, you know? I mean, you may want to be still by not running anymore, but to actually be in kind of a state of silence and stillness, no. Slow, deep breathing brings you to stillness. It magnifies what will come through that point of stillness and silence that will provide you many gifts of spirit. It opens the portal wide, Saint Germain says, when you have the holy breath going through you, through your lungs. And, you know, this morning I was in bed, you know, I got up very early, then I went back to bed and beamed with this beamer. And while I was beaming for 16 minutes, I just did deep, deep, slow breathing where I physically, you know, expanded my lungs as much as I could stand and held it and then released it slowly and gently until all the breath was expired out of my body, and then did that again. So a lot of times we can breathe in nature. It's wonderful to be outside by trees, by greenery, to get the extra wonderful oxygen and the prana and the environment by trees and plants. If you can't go outside, if it's too cold or whatever, or too hot, then do it in your home. And just, you know, learn how to do very deep, slow breathing. It's very powerful. It helps digestion, it helps assimilation, it helps you to release toxins out of your body. You know, I can tell you there have been probably 2 to 3 dozen times in sessions that we've had with the Holy Spirit, the soul-raising sessions, at least 2 or 3 dozen times, the Holy Spirit has told people to do 5 to 15 minutes of slow, deep, pranic breathing a day. They've told this over and over to different people, especially people that had physical ailments, because the breath will heal. And doing this one thing, along with whatever else you're doing, is transmutative. It's powerful. It's, you will heal faster and you will stay healthy longer, Saint Germain says, when with what other health practices you engage in, dietary, everything, you also do pranic breathing. It's so powerful. I mean, look at Boyd. You know, here's a guy, just turned 60. He looks like he's 40. And he is a master of this art, this science of using the holy breath. He's talked about it. He's given many teachings on his experience with it and meditation and using the breath. So if Boyd can do this and looks 20 years younger than he is, you know, we can do it. You can do it. So if you're worried about aging, don't worry. Be happy and breathe deeply, right? So that's just one example in our midst. Okay. Any other questions?
I have a quick one. Yeah, I've used all these portals, and I do, and they're very useful for getting beyond the intellect and the 4 lower bodies, the duality consciousness, and they're good for getting deeper, deeper, deeper in, which are 2 different phases of this. And I'd like to say that I benefited a lot from focusing on a tactile feeling within all these. And it feels to me like something like my soul is doing something. I'm pressing my soul into something and then feeling it, just like touching things, you know? And I thought I'd ask the master if he could just, what's going on when that's happening? Well, I think I know, but say
through silence and stillness, you become more soulful. So if you'd like to be more soulful, you know, rich in soulfulness, or soulful in terms of being more energetic within your soul, which is, you know, our essence, our individuality, but our essence, our unique personality, which is becoming our divine individuality, then do these things to learn how to become still quicker and through silence enter this state of being. So, yes, the soulfulness expands. And Saint Germain is showing me, like a balloon, how your soul actually expands. As you do these things, your soul becomes larger in its power, in its cosmic magnetic reach into outer space and inner space to be able to do greater spiritual work. So the more you master meditation and stillness and silence, the greater spiritual work you can do because you are more soulful. You have more divine energy flowing through you, manifesting both in your mind, but also in your heart, in your will. And remember, we love God with our entire heart, mind, strength, and soul. Now, the soul is the last one mentioned. It's kind of mysterious. Yet, when you love God with your entire soul, it's really your essence, your being, you know, your inner essence. That's what your soul is. So, to love God with our entire soul is that mystical, magical formula that brings us to the point of then allowing the soul to merge with the spirit, our I Am presence. So we start with the threefold flame, the threefold, the love, our heart, mind, strength, which is our will, and then the soul. And so the soul rises, this balloon, magically and naturally, when we've expanded the threefold flame and done our meditation practice and entered the light through love and surrender and being in nature and be mindful listening, and then the soul merges with spirit. So that's the key. That is the magic point that we are all coming to, the merging of our soul with spirit.
Here's a simple one that some people would say you just have to feel it, but maybe there's a hint on this. Elizabeth Clare Prophet commented once that they're super good chelas that know they have to do something, and they meditate, and they think maybe I better throw in a little research, and they think about it, and they work on it, and they're thinking about it, and the opportunity is gone. There is an old saying, the answer was found in a dead giveaway, but let's call us a live giveaway. When would we sense that we're doing too much inner stuff and it's about the time to kick ourselves into action and go out and it's an odd saying, but Mark Prophet would say this, beat the world into submission.
Well, the lazy ones are not true meditators. Meditation is both a quiescent state of being, yet it's a powerful, active inner experience with God. So it is doing great good when you're meditating, if you're doing meditation in a spirit that is one with God. Meditation and prayer are both important. Prayer is, in effect, talking to God. Meditation is listening to God, God within you. And action and work is love made visible, love made tangible. So once you're done meditating, once you're done praying, you have to act. Otherwise, those prayers and those meditations are not fully activated in the most powerful, authoritative ways. Yet, we can't downplay the importance of meditation because it's not just being lazy or doing nothing. You're actually doing a lot. In fact, some of the greatest masters meditate, and in their meditation, they're doing tremendous, tremendous work for souls throughout the planet. They may be leaving their body, visiting souls, energizing them, teaching them, blessing them, healing them. So the higher you go in meditation, you actually can levitate out of your body, you can translate out of your physical body and do great spiritual work, and you can even bilocate, and beyond bilocation, you can send your causal body essences and your electronic presences throughout the planet to prevent wars, to prevent violence, to prevent accidents and negative things happening to people. I think many of us have had the experience of leaving our body and doing this work. Sometimes you don't remember it, sometimes you do. So inherent in your question is maybe the sense that we're not doing when we're meditating. And yet the true meditators are doing. It's just a different type of doing that's very important. And it's a spiritual doing that can be a powerful dynamic, as powerful as working at a soup kitchen or feeding the poor. You may be working at a divine soup kitchen and pouring forth food, spiritual food, to souls who require that type of nourishment on the inner. And you may be helping people in a very powerful spiritual way that's not as hands-on as other people think that they need to be engaged. Now, does this mean that we don't do physical work? Of course not. We do. And a balanced life where you do all the above is tethered to reality, replete with physicality in terms of bringing heaven to earth through physical movement, action, work, service. Yet we don't downplay the importance of meditation, because when we meditate and enter that still space of pure beingness, then when we do our work and service, we're centered, we're one, we're loving, we're kind, we're empowered by the light that we invoke. And we then utilize that empowerment, that love, that light, to serve others in a greater measure, with even more dynamism than if we had not meditated or prayed. So all of the above are important. Our Christ self, our Buddha self, will enlighten us as to each day's needs and requirements, both for us and for life and for others. Like I was sharing at the beginning, you know, this morning I could have done my normal prayer routine and meditation routine. I knew I was coming here for 3 hours, and the lawn had to be mowed. So I used the opportunity to mow the lawn for an hour and a half while I was singing all kinds of new creative songs to the elementals and Violet Flame and Hail Marys and et cetera, et cetera. And I felt super rejuvenated. I felt close to the elementals. So I was doing both. I was working and I was loving and praying and singing at the same time. So I think that, and this is Saint Germain answering this question because it really related to the last session. He's saying that we have to live balanced lives. We can't just do one or the other exclusively, because then we're not living in reality, right? So the doing becomes more powerful when we enter beingness first. And likewise, the beingness becomes powerful when, after we're in the beingness state, we're doers, we're true doers, putting our faith into action through works. So faith without works is dead. You know, faith without works is dead. Yet, meditation and prayer without activity and work to back it up is also not as dynamic as it could be. So with God, both in meditation and in work, both of them become powerful, wonderful, energetic, enlivening, enriching to our spirit and all spirits. So the key is that God is within us, and God is front and center within both the meditation and the prayer and the work and service. When you're centered on God, doing any and all of these, then that godness, that light, that divine energy makes everything wonderful, beautiful, and blissful. Our work becomes blissful. I mean, I was shivering. I had shorts on this morning. It was 34 degrees, and I should have worn longer pants, but I was so in love with God and life that I didn't think about it until I was about done. So you can be meditating and in bliss, and time goes by so quickly, it's unreal, or it's really real, but, you know, time isn't real anyway. And you can be working and in love with God, and you just blaze through the day, everything goes swiftly, and you're not in the doldrums of the sense of toil and drudgery, right? You've experienced this when you're doing your work out in nature. It's all about your consciousness. Yes, you're focused on making sure you're doing what you're doing, yet when your consciousness is also elevated through a mindful spirit and a wise heart and a loving heart, the day goes very quickly. We've all experienced this, right? So it's really, we bring our meditation joy into our work, and it becomes suffused with such stupendous energy that our work becomes play, right? And our toil is no longer drudgery. You know, even the hard things where we do hard physical work become playful and fun because we make them a game. We make them interesting and different and enlivening and enriching. And it's nice to work with others. If you're always working by yourself, it's a little hard to master this because you don't have someone else to kind of engage with and feed off of, so to speak, and interact with. And so that's why community is so important, because we are always enriched in our interactivity with others. If we're doing everything solo, it's like, it can be very nurturing in one sense, you and God, yet sometimes we have to interact with others just because we require that community, that fellowship, that brother-sisterhood, and that builds something deep within us that's very soulful and very healthy to augment our own individual attainment, self-realization, enlightenment. When we work in community and with others, our enlightenment experience is enriched by the enlightenment of every other person. Our self-realization is enriched by the light and the self-realization of every other person. We share, we feed off of each other's greatness, godness, goodness, and we support one another in this endeavor. And this is why coming into unity, community, is so important for the Aquarian age, because it's hard to do it only by yourself. It's easier to get depressed. It's easier to morph into this woe is me state where the work is intense and drudgery. And by working together in teams, we actually can do more synergistically than we can do just by ourselves. It's like when you're unloading a truck. I've done this many times. If I have a person to give something to, they can receive it, and you know, it goes a lot quicker than if I'm alone hopping up on the truck, getting the thing, hopping off the truck and putting it somewhere else. I mean, it's ridiculous. You have to have two or three people when you're doing certain work for it to be the best, right? It's to be synergistically not a time waster. So look at this spiritually in terms of when we meditate together, the energy in the room that we collaborate with the higher selves of each person activate within us something beautiful, fresh, divine, and holy that we may not have accessed completely on our own. We could maybe if we've done meditation for 30, 40 years and we've really mastered the science. Yet when we are together, there is this sacred dynamic of the union of our highest, like the numerator in an equation, right? The highest numerator then is expanded, it's multiplied. And then we have this synergistic effect that is very, very important for the golden age. So I think Saint Germain desired to expand a little bit on the answer to your question, because if we only meditate or pray by ourselves, we're missing possibilities that exist in community that are very important for culturing, and he's using this term, culturing the new age. So the new age, it will be a divine culture, but to culture the new age requires people, you know, working in unison, working in teams, working in committees, working together. That is the egregor that the master Peter Dunov and the master Omar Mikhail Ivanhoe spoke of, that is part of this we, us dynamic that's so important. Community is what I was looking for when I was 18, searching for a spiritual community. I think it's what many of us desire, because in collaboration, cooperation, we can do a lot more together, right? I'm learning right now a lot from Marlena. I'm taking classes that she's preparing and learning all about the body temple from different aspects of different healing modalities. And this is going to be ongoing for a while. Why? Why am I doing this as messenger training? In order to learn from an expert who's studied and become a doctor, a naturopath, keys that will help me both in maintaining my health and vitality and wellness and in helping others who the masters bring to our movement, whether it's in soul-raising sessions, whether it's in direct interaction, whether it's in the Morya discipleship sessions, and a new one that's going to be happening very soon with Sana Kumara for our staff. So if I can even work on myself to become more whole than I currently am, and I find the deficiencies in me or the lacks or the issues or the habit patterns that I know are not serving me, and I can have a doctor who's an expert reflect back to me what she sees in my face and my skin and my ears and my feet and my whatever, because of all of her studies, it's motivating me to be a better person, to become humble enough, even in my state of being a messenger, to actually go deeper and to self-heal at deeper and deeper and deeper levels. So I'm kind of bearing my soul a little bit on this, but we all have to keep learning. We all have to keep growing. We all have to keep expanding. So every meditation experience, every work experience, every interactivity with another person is an opportunity to learn, to grow, and to self-master who we are and what we're becoming. And if we are doing our deepest and highest work, we're always in a state of kind of self-assessment where we're mindful of what is going on both outwardly and inwardly. And we're using our higher minds to observe kind of objectively from a very high vantage point so that what we are actually doing translates to our becoming more of God, our becoming closer to God, our merging with God, merging with our divine self, letting go of the human, the ego, the lesser self, the not self, more and more, allowing it to just disappear through our mindfulness, through our oneness, through our love. And then we benefit all life through our self-realization, enlightenment, and ascension. We benefit every sentient being on the earth when we rise a notch in consciousness every day. Why? Because we are helping raise the entire culture, the entire civilization. Because we are a collective. We are all one in our higher self, in light already. Yet we're self-realizing this dynamic through 3D, living in this physical plane, so we can't diminish the importance of the physical work, the physical service, the physical activity. It's so important. We incarnated, so it must be important. You know, we're in a physical body. It's important. So we don't just put off till after we die heaven. You know, we're here to bring heaven to earth. The great masters all say this. They're not here to just say it's all unreal here, and therefore we might as well just meditate and pray and not do much physically, and just we hope for the new day and we, you know, we'll get there after we die. No. We're here doing physical work. So back to your question. You're a doer, Daniel. You do physical work. That work is important for your clients. And so the masters hear you, and they honor the fact that even at your tender elder years and age, you're doing hard physical work. I mean, you're an amazing person to be able to do this at your age. It's a humble job. It's an important job. And so because you have lived consciously, you have attempted to learn about the truth, speak the truth on the radio, etc., that truth is serving you and will continue to serve you to be your best, to be a God-man wherever you are, whatever you're doing, and that is wonderful. So thank you for the question. So do we have any other questions?
They signed in as KAK. I think it might be Catherine Kemick. She says, I don't feel my threefold flame. Occasionally, I feel fire burning in my heart, though. Certain life situations will touch my heart, and I may feel the fire. Or most often, though, my heart feels very heavy from situations. Sometimes I can hardly breathe. Decrees can clear the weight or physical activity. So why and what do I do to feel my threefold flame?
Well, go to a time when you felt great love, appreciation, joy, spontaneity, creativity, and when you were just in bliss. Okay, and go back into that moment of bliss and of feeling like super happy and stay with that remembrance, that memory of being happy and love and bliss, excited, feeling virtuous, feeling whole, feeling who you truly are, feeling creative. And allow that feeling to just wrap itself around your entire aura and then penetrate into your every part of your aura and into your heart. And the memory is a type of feeling. It's etched in Akasha, and so grab from Akasha, if you like, or accept from Akasha the joy and the excitement and the, you know, the wonderment, the awe of some time in your life when you just felt totally loved, totally appreciated, totally validated. I mean, loved unconditionally, you know? And if necessary, maybe it's like when your mother held you and nursed you. You may have to go back, even if you don't remember it physically, there's a memory in Akasha where this your mother just loved you. Here's my new child, my beautiful new daughter, and was nursing you and taking care of you and feeding you, etc. When you can feel that love, then your threefold flame is enlivened in that moment. It's actually accentuated. It's highlighted. And stay with that feeling as long as you can until it permeates your whole being and you feel this rush. You know, we all have experienced, you know, the a hair standing up on our arms, and like a wave or a rush of light or energy, right? I mean, I hope everybody's experienced it. I get it every day, but it's like feeling a rush of light and love. Well, go back to that experience of feeling that rush, and then stay with that as long as is necessary to have it permeate your whole being and excite your heart, and then visualize your threefold flame dancing. And each of these flames is alive. Just see them as live beings, actually. You know, you can call it Mr. Blue, Mr. Yellow, Mr. Pink, or Mrs. Blue, Mrs. Yellow, Mrs. Pink, or Miss. And treat your threefold flame as actually like little beings, okay? And you're talking to them, and you're coaxing them to expand and to give you their sense of what who they are and what they feel. You know, treat them as actual virtual, as real beings, okay? So when you treat them as alive within you, then they become alive, and they will serve you, and they will stimulate you. I think this is the answer Saint Germain desired to give, because sometimes we can't accept something as real and alive when it really is, but we haven't experienced it. So we have to be playful like a child with our imagination to give it that reality, that sense of being real. So become like a child and allow your threefold flame to be so real, so front and center, that you use whatever means you want with your imagination to make it work for you and be real. So that's his answer. So thank you, Catherine. Okay, one more.
Carol Lazar says, I've been meditating with a group on Zoom since we are staying at home. Do you feel that it works, this meditation together in a group?
Absolutely. What you do, though, is you can visualize going up through your crystal cord into your I Am Presence. And then from the point of your I Am Presence, you're perfectly in alignment with and attunement with and collaborating with every other person's I Am Presence, your higher self. And then you see all of those higher selves as one being, actually, one light, one being. So when you merge in consciousness and visualization, it's a powerful dynamic, and then you can have downloaded through that crystal cord right into your mind, heart, and being, your soul, even more powerful essences that will support your meditation and support what you're doing collectively. You know, when David Wilcox, you know, leads at the end of his 3 or 5 hour sessions, you know, meditation, and his wife comes out and does the bowls, all that, I mean, they're not, you know, I would call not the highest forms of meditation, but to have that many people is powerful. And he's doing the best he can based on his upbringing and his spiritual path. And it's great, you know, for what it is. Now, when you invoke the masters, when you invoke these great divine beings to actually be the being who is organizing and conducting this session, it becomes, you know, mathematically, both arithmetically and, what's the other term? Higher than arithmetic. Geometrically more powerful when the masters are doing that conducting of the session. So always invoke the great beings of light, whoever you choose to be there to center all of the activity and regulate it, and then utilize it for the highest good, for the planet, for people, for, you know, elementals, nature, etc. Because we can do a lot through our higher self, but the great masters, through their transcendence, can do it better than we can humanly. So yeah, it works, Carol. You have to accept it, believe it, see it, feel it. And as you see it, feel it, accept it, and know it, then you will experience higher and higher states of this collective power of the meditation on Zoom. It's very, very neat.